Hello all, this is Umesh, History Faculty at Manifest IAS, and as this is the current JOTS program, and as part of this program we are covering the World Heritage Sites of India, which have been designated by UNESCO for their outstanding contribution or outstanding universal value. They have been designated, and as part of this series we had already had a discussion on the cave architecture of India. And in this lecture we are going to talk about the Buddhist heritage sites in India, how they have been designated, which sites have been designated, what is their significance, what is their significance in a history, what is their significance with respect to religion, that is Buddhism. Then apart from that, what is their significance with respect to the contribution to architecture, all of these factors and facets we are going to have a look at today. And as part of this, first we are going to have a look at what are the UNESCO World Heritage Sites which are part of Buddhist heritage in India. The first and foremost is Sanchi Stupa, the second one is the Bodh Gaya Temple, and the third one is the Nalanda University. The Nalanda University, which is present in Bihar, Sanchi Stupa, it is present in Madhya Pradesh. So these are the things which we are going to have a look at today. What are they and how they are very significant, we are going to have a look at. Now, let's start with the 10 criteria which is present. I think I have repeated myself enough number of times, but once more, see, the thing is, whenever a UNESCO World Heritage site is designated, first it should be of outstanding universal value. Then along with that, they also have provided nearly 10 criteria for selection of a World Heritage Site. And as part of this World Heritage Site, it's not just about the cultural sites, but even some of the natural sites have also been included into this categorization. And the first and foremost is the masterpiece of human creative genius. To exhibit interchange of human values is something which is very, very important. Then unique or exceptional testimony to cultural tradition, illustrative of significant stage in human history. All of these things are very, very significant. And today, as part of our lecture, we will have a look at how Sanchi Stupa has evolved, what is the architectural features of this Sanchi Stupa, and along with that we will have a look at the regional history of Sanchi. Then after that we will have a look at which of these criteria Sanchi Stupa fulfills, which of these criteria we will have a look at. So this starts our discussion. So
subscribe now and press the bell icon, never miss an update.
So first we are going to have a look at, this is the Sanchi Stupa, this is the stupa number 1 which is present in Madhya Pradesh, this is the stupa number 1. Apart from this is stupa number 1, there are two other stupas, which is stupa number 2 and stupa number 3, which have been decently preserved. The other stupas have completely been destroyed. At one point of time it is said that this Sanchi, it had numerous stupas. What is this stupa exactly, what is its significance in Buddhism, we will have a look at now. When it comes to the stupa architecture, stupa, it is a representation of a mound. A mound or relics. Usually whenever a dead person is buried, obviously when he is buried, there is a mound which is formed on the dead person. This mound is a place of worship for folk religions at one point of time. When Buddha was born, he preached his religion and he died. A stupa was constructed which replicated this burial mound initially, and with the time and with the development of religion, this small mound, it developed with complete embellishments into a stupa. And this is a part of evolution of this architectural style called stupa architectural style. And the Sanchi Stupa is the best representation of this stupa style. Best preserved representation of this stupa style in India. Definitely Amaravati Stupa is also considered to be one of the significant stupas, but it did not survive the ravages of time. So that is the reason why we are going to have a look at Sanchi Stupa. And when it comes to this stupa architecture, it is typically having a what shape? Base is this one, rectangular shape, and on this spherical or semi-spherical structure is constructed. This is how a typical stupa will look like for you. It is a semi-spherical solid structure. It means that you cannot enter inside a stupa at any point of time. It is a completely closed structure on all sides. And this is hemispherical structure is known as anda, which is built with bricks, and outside portion is typically plastered, and inner side there are only bricks. The outer side bricks are usually baked, and the inner side bricks are just dried bricks. Okay, this is one feature. Then these are solid but not hollow, as we have discussed earlier. And most of these stupas, they are surrounded by railings, okay, which actually segregate the sacred from profane. Sacred means which is the sacred space, just like the Prakara walls in Dravidian architecture, which differentiate between the secular and religious spheres, or secular and spiritual spheres. In a similar fashion, these railings also, they separate the secular from the religious aspect of this stupa. And when it comes to these separation, okay, these railings are also called Vedikas. And these railings, they typically have this structure. Okay, I'll draw it for you. I think you can see it. Okay, this way. This is the railing structure. Okay, this is how the railings typically look. In this, Ushnisha is the horizontal bars are called Ushnisha. Suchi is the vertical bar. Vertical bar is Suchi. Horizontal bars are called Ushnishas. At the intersection of these two, you have what do you have? You have this medallion kind of structure. Obviously, at the intersection of two things, there will be a spherical, there will be a medallion kind of structure. Okay, it is not exactly spherical. It is a medallion which is made, and on this relief sculpture is also made. So this is how the entire outer line is depicted. I'll show the images also for you. And in fact, there will be two pradakshina paths, one on the base. Okay, inside the railings, between the railing and the stupa, there will be a space which is known as a pradakshina path. This is the lower level pradakshina path, and on the stupa. On the stupa also you find one pradakshina patha, because the cylindrical thing which is present on a platform which is present on which the stupa is built, it is a little bigger than the spherical stupa. That's why you find one more pradakshina path on top, okay, which is known as Medhi, and to access this higher platform, higher pradakshina path, you need to take steps which is known as Sopana. There will be staircases and Medhi, which is the first floor pradakshina path, then there will be a ground floor pradakshina path, then there is a Torana or gateway. Okay, then apart from this, in these gateways or Vedikas, in between them at four spots in Sanchi, okay, let's suppose this is one more gateway, okay, the first gateway and the second gateway are present. In between them, you find one Torana. Okay, Torana is an entrance gateway. Entrance gateway, how it is present, we are going to have a discussion about it too. So just I am telling that in this format there will be Toranas too. Then apart from that, you have structures like Harmika, Dande and Chetris. All of these things are present on top of the on top of the stupa, which is this hemispherical image. There will be a platform. This platform is known as Harmike. On top of which there is a vertical bar which is known as Dande. Dande means the vertical bar. Then apart from that, this Dande vertical bar, there are umbrella kind of structures on this Dande which is known as Chetri. Typically, umbrella is a representation of royalty in ancient India. Any person who is either royal in blood or who attained higher stages of spirituality, they are represented by this Chetri. Okay, this is one more thing. Then there are three different kinds of stupas. One is Dhatugarbha, Paribhajaka and Uddeshika stupa. The Dhatugarbha stupa, it is typically a representation of the Dhatugarbha stupa contains the Buddha's relics. Paribhajaka is a stupa which contains the belongings of monks, whereas Uddeshika stupa, it is constructed when a person's wish is fulfilled in Buddhism. So all of these things are different kinds of stupas, and most of these stupas, they are embellished with the images of Yakshas and Yakshis who are folk deities. This is the integrative element of Buddhism, wherein it accepted the folk deities like Nagas, Yakshas, Yakshinis. All of them are became part of the Buddhist pantheon. Okay, then apart from that, there is very good finish and decoration in all these stupas, and most of the medallions that I talked about, which are at the intersection of the vertical and horizontal bar, they are contain Jataka stories, and the images are carved typically in low, both low and high relief. So this is the typical structure. Okay, here you can see very clearly the image also. This is the Anda, okay, the upraised platform Medhi, and Pradakshina path will be present here. Vedika is this. Toranas are present at four corners. You can see it. Okay, Harmika, you can see Chhatri, you can see. All of these things are part of the typical Buddhist stupa architecture. Okay, this is the representational image. Now, when it comes to the site Sanchi. Okay, now we have discussed the broader architectural features of a stupa. When it comes to the site Sanchi, in Sanchi, apart from the stupa, you find Ashokan pillar with four lion capital is also present. Then apart from that, this place is known for its early temples. Okay, the earliest temples in India after Bitargaon, which is present in Rajasthan, are present in Sanchi too. Okay, in Sanchi too we have early stupas. Then apart from that, one famous inscription called A Dharma Hetu, which talks about the dependent origination theory in Buddhism, that is also present here in the Sanchi stupa, and it is also a representation of Mauryan architecture. You can find temples, okay, monasteries are also present, monolithic pillars and stupas, all of these things are present here. And the first and foremost, when it comes to the history of this site, the first stupa here is built by Emperor Ashoka in 3rd century BC. It is a small stupa, and this stupa is formed the base for the Sanchi stupa number 1. Then after that, this stupa has been further enlarged, and it has been added with gateways and decorations during the period of Shatavahanas. And along with the Shatavahanas, during the post-Mauryan period, other ruling dynasties also contributed to the construction of the Sanchi stupa. And the construction activity, it continued during the Guptan period too, and later during the time or till the 12th century AD, till Buddhism was popular in India, Sanchi was a significantly important pilgrimage site too. So this is the history of Sanchi. Okay, Mauryan Empire, Guptan Empire contributed. Great stupa number 1 I talked about. Stupa number 2 and 3 are also present along with stupa number 1. And Shungas and Shatavahanas, both of them, they contributed. Okay, so here the most important aspect is Sanchi encompasses most of the evolution of ancient Indian architecture and ancient Buddhist architecture in India from the early stage of Buddhism, and it's a first artistic expression. This is very, very important. All the architecture, Buddhist architecture in India, Sanchi represents a park where you can clearly see the evolution of Buddhist architecture from preliminary burial mounds to the stage of the classical stupa, which is Sanchi stupa, to evolution of temple architecture also is present in Sanchi. That is why it is a World Heritage Site. Then apart from that, okay, here the most important thing that we have to discuss about in Sanchi is, as I have pointed out, okay, the Torana is the most important aspect that we have to talk about. And on this Torana, you can find the images of cheerful and busy realism of India. And you can find the images of Shalabanjika. Shalabanjika is a Yakshi. She is the emblem of prosperity and fertility. Her images also you can find in the typical Indian traditional pose, which is known as a Tribhang pose. Okay, it has been asked as UPSC question. Tribhang means thrice bent body. Then apart from that, you find the images of Jatakas and life and times of Buddha. All of these things are present on these Toranas. They have been depicted in relief sculpture. Okay, these are the Toranas. I'll talk about the Torana architecture once. Okay, the Toranas typically they contain these kind of pillars. And on top of these pillars, you find capitals called pillar capitals. Okay, I'll show all the images to you. And over and above this, on top of this, you find these kind of structures which are known as horizontal bars, which are known as architraves. Because of these architraves and the pillars, the exact joining point of these architraves and the pillar, it creates some niche. Niche means any specific functional space is known as niche. It is present in biology too. Niche is typically any functional space. And here also you can find at these edges, these are the niches. These horizontal bars are called architraves. These vertical bars are called pillars. And here you can see the capitals. I think in this image, the capitals are not very clearly visible, but the niche is visible, the architrave is visible, the pillar is visible. I'll talk about what are the images which are present. Okay, this is the image of Shalabanjika. She is present in the thrice bent Tribhanga pose in this image. This is the pillar. Then apart from this, you can find the architrave images. Okay, this is the architrave image. And here this image, it shows Emperor Ashoka. See here, Emperor Ashoka, he is visiting Sanchi. Okay, and he is also the person who distributed the relics of Buddha across India. He is the one who distributed them. And Sanchi stupa number 1 is a Dhatugarbha stupa, which contains the original relics of Buddha. Okay, apart from this, many other images are present. I'll show you. Okay, this is the image of Buddha. Okay, before his enlightenment, here you can see Mara and his army, they are all Rakshasas or desires. Okay, they are trying to disturb Buddha, but Buddha is very much concentrated upon his own meditation. Here, one more peculiar thing about this architecture or this sculpture is that Buddha is never represented in human form. Here, Buddha is represented in the format of a Bodhi tree. in the format of a Bodhi tree, okay, which symbolizes the enlightenment of Buddha. Because here the most important aspect is that the sculptors who are present, they were very afraid that if they try to depict Buddha, it will reduce the gods or Buddha's image, okay, because he cannot be confined to human form. This was the fear which the artist carried. That's the reason why they never depicted the images of Buddha, the images of Buddha. It is an iconic form of Buddha, an iconic form of Buddha, and he is represented mostly in symbols at Sanchi. Okay, then apart from this, if you have a look at, see, these are the capitals. See the beautiful capitals. These are Eksha capitals. This is the capital of elephant. This is the lion capital. All of these things are capitals which are present on the pillars, Then apart from this, I'll show some other images. See, this is the medallion structure, the exact juncture between in the Vedika, between the horizontal and vertical bars. In this medallion, people are praying to Buddha who attained enlightenment. This is the Bodhi tree. Okay, Buddha is not represented, an iconic Buddha. Then apart from that, there is also one Ashokan pillar which contains the four lion capital. Okay, even though it is destroyed. See, this is not the emblem of India. The Sarnatha stupa, Ashokan capital is the emblem of India. This is not the emblem of India. In fact, it is a little different with respect to the Sarnatha emblem. Here, when it comes to the capital, it is also a four-lion capital, but the abacus, it has a different images when compared to Sarnatha sculpture. When compared to Sarnatha capital, this abacus images are different, and this is not our Indian emblem, okay, but it contains the same four lion capital, and it contains the same Mauryan polish, okay, the refined polish of Mauryans, you can see. Then apart from this, I told you earlier that it also represents the earliest evolution of temples in India, and this is a representational image of temple number 40, which is a Hindu temple, and it was constructed during the Guptan period. Okay, see, you can see the same structure it has. Okay, it has the plan of vestibule. Okay, the top is in the format of a vestibule or shala, okay, which is a hutmet like structure. This entire structure was made in wood and it has been completely destroyed. Now we have the riser platform along with the pillar potholes. That's it. And apart from that, we have the earliest temple structures which are constructed during Guptan period. These are flat roof temple structures, okay, with a pillared portico and central sanctum sanctorum. There is nothing else. Okay, this is also represented, and this is a Buddhist temple. This is in fact a Buddhist temple. So you can see a clear evolution from burial mound to stupa to temple architecture, the formative phase of temple architecture. So all of these elements are present in Sanchi. So that is the reason why Sanchi is a very brilliant example of evolution of a Buddhist architecture and heritage in India. That is the reason why it has been selected as UNESCO World Heritage Site 2. Okay, UNESCO World Heritage Site 2. I think I have discussed about these things. Erected pillars, apsidal hall. Okay, some of the temples, they contained apsidal hall. Okay, here you can see this hall is apsidal in plan. Okay, even though it is not very clearly visible, apsidal means half elliptical shape. Okay, this way, half elliptical shape. So this is how the Sanchi stupa is made. All of these elements we have discussed. We have had a look at the Sanchi stupa along with its architecture. Then apart from that, we discussed about the images which are present on the Thorana. Okay, all of these things. We also talked about how Ashoka was represented, because some of the questions have been asked even in this format, too. Okay, for example, last year they asked a question on Ranayo Ashoka, where has this inscription been found? Okay, Kangan Halli. It was very difficult. Okay, in fact, that similar kind of question can be asked here too. There is also a image of a depiction of the battle, in order to claim the Buddhist relics too. So all of these things are present in Sanchi when it comes to the entire thing. Okay, now if we have a look at the criteria, it is definitely outstanding human universal value, masterpiece of human creative genius, definitely, because and to exhibit interchange of human values, this criteria is not very clearly there. An unique or exceptional testimony to a cultural tradition, yes, this also is present. Then illustrative of a significant stage in human history, this is also present. So I think 1, 2, 1, 3, and 4 criteria are fulfilled in Sanchi stupa. Okay, this finishes the discussion on Sanchi stupa. We will meet again and we will discuss about two Buddhist structures, which is Bodh Gaya and Nalanda. Bodh Gaya and Nalanda in our next video. And you can, for questions on this Sanchi stupa, you can check the description below. You'll find questions. Please answer them and do subscribe to Manifest IAS. Thank you.